I was allergic, to my surprise, to the penicillin that was prescribed. When I walked into my physician's office covered in hives, my throat closing, I walked up to the door, to the front desk, and I said, I'm Jeanne Nicholson, and I'm going into anaphylactic shock. And the woman behind the desk said, that'll be a $20 copay. I've been licensed to practice nursing in Colorado for 50 years. I started in the Gunnison Memorial Hospital, and you know, when people walked in that hospital, we didn't say, how are you going to pay for your care? We asked, what's wrong and how can we help? During that 50-year period, what I've seen is a trend to make profit the priority instead of the patient. I think the patient needs to be the priority in our healthcare payment system. And for that reason, I am passionately supporting Colorado Care Amendment 69. And I would be very delighted to tell you all about it tonight. So, Colorado Care Amendment 69 will cover every Colorado resident, and it will save you and I billions of dollars. So what's wrong with our current system? Well, what's wrong with our current system is that even with the passage of the Affordable Care Act, we still can't afford health care. Ironically enough, even though it's called the Affordable Care Act, many of us cannot afford health care, and the cost of it is going up. Now, the good news is that the Affordable Care Act did mean that many people with pre-existing conditions could get coverage that they weren't able to get before the passage of the Affordable Care Act. That was the good news from my perspective. And I think many more Americans are aware of the cost of healthcare now because of the passage of that act. But the weakness is that healthcare will never be universal because it's too expensive for many people. And let me show you why. So, a little hard to read the screen. Hopefully you can see it. The good news is the blue bars are showing that there are fewer people that are uninsured right now because of the Affordable Care Act. We still, however, have 350,000 in Colorado that are uninsured. But the red bars are also very concerning because they're going in the wrong direction. We have an increase in the number of people in Colorado that are underinsured. So counting both groups together, we have over 1 million people in our state out of 5.3 million people who can't afford health care. Now the people who are underinsured have coverage, but they can't afford to use it because the deductibles are so high. And I contend that the rest of us who've been lucky enough to have health care are also being hoodwinked because we're paying far more for our health care than we really need to. A lot of that money is not being used wisely, and I think there's a better way to use that money so that it benefits those of us in Colorado to make sure that we're healthy. The United States, compared to all of the other developed countries, has the worst record. We pay the most, and that's the left bar, for our health care, and we get the worst outcomes, and we don't cover everybody. Every other industrialized nation covers everyone, and they don't cost as much as we do, and they get better health outcomes. Can anyone in the group tell me
what the oldest universal health care program is, which country has the oldest universal health care system?
England.
Many people guess England. It's actually Germany. So can anybody guess when did Germany start universal health care? It was actually the late 1800s. So when the opposition likes to talk about the fact that this has never been tried before, that's just not so. It hasn't been tried before in the United States, but it has been tried everywhere else in the world, in the developed countries, and it's been in force for a very long time with tremendous success, and this slide is a demonstration of that. Well, so how does that work? I mean, some people say to me, well, Jeanne, this sounds too good to be true. How could you possibly cover everybody and have excellent coverage for them and save money? How would you save money when you're covering everybody? Well, here's why. Because there is a great deal of money in our healthcare payment system that is wasted on for-profit companies and on administrative costs that are unnecessary. We can increase our taxes to $25 billion, and this will be the only example that I know of where that tax increase is actually a cost savings. Usually a tax increase isn't a cost savings. It's more that we're going to pay, like for a new library or a recreation center or a new road. But this is different. This is replacing something. So this is a tax increase that ends up being a cost savings because we're paying out of pocket right now, Coloradans are paying $30+ billion for our premiums and our deductibles and our copays. We'll be paying $25 billion in a tax increase when this passes. That's a significant savings. So one good example of where we know we can make a huge dent in our costs is in how much we pay chief executive officers and other administrators. What do you think the chief executive officer of United Health's compensation package was in 2014? What did he make? And that was, by the way, after an economic downturn when he had to take a pay cut. What do you think he made? $66.1 million. We don't have to pay that much for our chief executive officer to administer our health care payment system in this state. So, here is another quick demonstration of how things have kind of gotten out of control. As I mentioned, when I first started practicing nursing to now, this is a slide that demonstrates how many administrators there are compared to how many physicians there are. Starting in the 1970s, when it looked kind of equal, to now, when disproportionately there are far more administrators in the healthcare payment system than there are physicians in this country. This slide is not meant to be one that you actually read, because it's too complicated, but the point of it is to show how difficult it is to navigate our current healthcare payment system and actually get coverage. These are all the steps you have to go through, even with the passage of the Affordable Care Act. We contend that it is far too complicated. It should be this simple. You're a Colorado resident, you get a smart card, you choose the provider of your choice, and you're set to go. So I've outlined what the problem was. Colorado Care Amendment 69 is the solution. Cover every Colorado resident and spend $4.5 billion less and have better coverage, even in the first year. Full full choice of a primary care provider. You won't have to choose a primary care provider in a narrow network like you do now with your health insurance. And how will this affect our providers? This is not socialized medicine. The healthcare providers will remain in private practice. They won't work for the state. And most of the physicians that I have talked to love this because they hate hassling with the for-profit health insurance companies that deny their claims, that they need to be reimbursed or hold up their money. And they hate having the insurance companies tell them how to practice medicine. They would much rather make sure that they were able to do the work that they really truly love to do, which is to take care of people. Now, the physicians, the therapists, the nurses are the good guys, as my six-year-old granddaughter calls them. They are the people who need to be compensated well because they're the people who take good care of us. So in this model, they will be well paid. They will be paid, according to the financial assessment, 133% of the Medicare rate. And most docs that I have talked to say, we can provide good medicine with that kind of reimbursement rate, particularly when we know every one of our patients will have a payment source. And when we send in a claim, you will pay us. You won't fight with us about whether or not the claim should be paid. We won't have to hire a whole lot of back office staff to process a whole bunch of paperwork for a lot of different insurance companies for every single one of our patients in order to get paid. So what kind of benefits can we offer? The benefit package is comprehensive. We call it a Platinum Plus benefit package, and I would particularly call your attention to mental health and substance use services, and also to alternative care by licensed providers, like massage therapists, like acupuncture, like chiropractors. All of those services are included in this package. Typically, the benefit packages are much more modest for our insurance that we have right now in terms of coverage. Other key points are no deductibles. None. No deductibles. No co-pays on preventive services and only modest co-pays on other kinds of services, and those can be waived in hardship cases. It is lifetime coverage. That means it is not tied to your employment. So if you're in between jobs, you're still covered as long as you're a Colorado resident. There is no discontinuation of your coverage just because you've changed jobs or your employer dropped the plan or whatever could have happened in your life right now to not have coverage. This won't happen. Everyone gets lifetime coverage with this particular plan as long as you're a resident. And the coverage is still good even if you're out of town and out of the state. So for example, you go to Florida for the winter, you get a sore throat, you get antibiotics for it because it's strep, and your doc that treats you in Florida sends the bill to Colorado Care pays the doc in Florida. So even when you're traveling, even if you've got a kid going to college in another state, as long as you're residents of Colorado, you're covered. This will eliminate enormous amounts of administrative waste. Right now, everything is siloed. And when you have silos, you have separate administrative costs for each one of those silos. When you combine those into one system, you can eliminate a lot of that unnecessary administrative cost. One example of that is the medical portion of workers' compensation. I was talking to a woman who moved here from Germany. She fell in love with a guy in Colorado, so she came here, but she used to work for the health coverage plans in Germany. And I was trying to explain this to her. I thought it was a language barrier. She just looked so blank. And finally, she said, well, why did you separate them out in the first place? We never did it that way. Why are they separate? We don't need to separate all of these payment systems. They can be combined, and they are in other countries. And that will save us significant money. So, more details. Raise your hand if you get to vote on your premium increase. No? No, of course not. With this measure, this cannot increase. This tax, premium tax increase, cannot go up without a vote, a majority vote, of the people in Colorado. So we then have control over those premium increases, not some people on a board of directors in another state who are trying to make sure that the stockholders make a lot of money, whether we get the care we need or not. This is exempt from Tabor because it says so, that it shall be exempt from Tabor. Now, it's exempt from Tabor because we need to make sure we have sufficient reserves so that we can have the funds to take care of the health care needs of the people in Colorado, even if there's an economic downturn. And you know, with Tabor, it can go down and then it's hard to get it to go back up. And it's not different from Tabor, however, in the sense that the people will always have the opportunity to vote on the tax increase, and it can't go up unless the people say it will go up. So what will it cost? 3 1/3% for employees and 6 2/3% for employers. And that's in place of the health insurance coverage that you have now. What kind of impact does that have on businesses? Right now, businesses are on average paying 13.5%. So 6 2/3% should look much better for them. And they're going to like the certainty that they know what the cost is for their budget next year and the year after that for their employees, rather than this sort of crapshoot where they're never really sure how much they're going to have to budget for healthcare for their employees in the future because the premiums keep going up and up and up in our current system. And they're going to like the fact that there is a significant reduction in costs in their workers' compensation costs because the medical portion will be folded into Colorado Care. So what happens to the people who are making money but not through payroll? For example, they maybe own some rental property and their income comes from that rental property. The group of people who make their living or make their income that's non-payroll will pay something equal to or less than 10%. The opposition likes to say it's across the board 10%, which is really deceptive. You need to understand that it's something equal to or less than 10% of your taxable income. So not all your income is taxable, only a portion of it is. And I can't really tell you exactly your individual circumstances and what you should pay and will pay when this passes. But I would encourage you to go to the ColoradoCare.org website, and there's a calculator on it, and it will help you if you plug in your data to figure out how much you can expect to pay. And another alternative is to take this to an accountant and ask them to look at it, because they already know what your circumstances, tax circumstances are, and they can help you figure out exactly what to expect. But you know, and I know, that we fall into different tax brackets, and so your tax could be somewhere between 5.5% and 8.5%, not 10%, depending on your tax bracket. So what about people like myself who are retired and on Medicare? We stay on A, B, and D, and Colorado Care becomes our supplemental. So we don't necessarily have to purchase a supplement to our coverage that we get from Medicare to still have a safety net below what Medicare doesn't cover. And again, you have to look at your own individual tax circumstances, but for myself and my husband, who file jointly, we know that the first $60,000 of our income from Social Security and PARA is exempt, and so we don't start paying a tax on our income until it's above that $60,000 threshold. So I thought you might like to see this too. The city of Alamosa is currently paying about $750,000 currently for their employees for health insurance and a medical portion of workers' compensation. With the passage of this act, they would pay about $270,000, and that's a significant savings, almost $500,000, and that's a 64% savings. So perhaps the people who live in the city of Alamosa can think of something that would be good for the community to have that they can't afford right now, that they could pay for with this savings, or simply to reduce taxes. So it's not just how it affects us as individuals, it's how it affects us as communities and as taxpayers in general. Same thing for Alamosa County. Almost $2 million is being spent now, and a significant savings because we would be paying in Alamosa County $585,000 plus for excellent coverage, no compromise to the employees, and a significant savings of over $1 million, or a 69% savings. How will this be governed? It'll be governed by initially 15-member Board of Trustees who are appointed by the leadership in the legislature and the governor, and ultimately by a 21-member board that is elected by the people of Colorado with representatives in 7 different geographic districts, 3 from each district. The opposition likes to talk about the fact that this group is unaccountable. They are definitely accountable to you, directly to you, the people of Colorado. Raise your hand if you know the names of the people who are serving on the board of directors for the for-profit health insurance company that serves you now. You probably don't know who they are. They are for sure not living here in Colorado, and their meetings are not transparent and the doors aren't open. But with Colorado Care, they will be transparent meetings. You can talk to them on the street like you talk to people like myself and Larry Crowder. You know that you have them available to you. So how will this impact Colorado's economy? We know that there'll be some people who will lose their jobs who work in the health insurance industry. We estimate that it is less than 5,000 people who will lose their jobs working for the for-profit health insurance companies. But we also know that there'll be more money circulating in Colorado's economy because of this $4.5 billion in the first year. And that money will be spent by people like you and I on other things that we would like to have, like maybe helping our kids go to college or pay our mortgage payments, all of those things. And that money circulates in our economy, and that creates other jobs. So we think, bottom line, there'll be a net gain in Colorado's economy and jobs. Well, a lot of people are concerned about this being embedded in the Constitution. I think that a lot of us are squirmish about that because of the results of the Tabor Amendment. However, there are some things that belong in a state constitution. In fact, healthcare is embedded in the constitutions of most of the industrialized nations because they believe it is a right. I think healthcare is a public resource like public libraries and public roads and public education, and it belongs in our state constitution because it's a right, just like trial by a jury or women's right to vote. Some people are concerned about whether we can do this one state at a time. Colorado has a big enough pool, 5.3 million residents. We have all the tertiary hospitals within our state to make sure that we can contract with those specialty providers when we need them, like National Jewish Hospital or Children's Hospital, Craig Hospital. And everyone will contribute based on their ability to pay. Vermont is an example of a state that the opposition likes to talk about, stating that, oh, it didn't work in Vermont, therefore it can't work here. But the truth is, they didn't meet any of these criteria I just listed. Not a big enough population, didn't have tertiary hospitals in their state, and it was not designed based on the fact that everyone would pay based on their ability to pay. They carved out deals for special groups and ended up with a situation where it was just too costly for the people who were left holding the bag, so to speak. So they're back to the drawing board. They're still determined to have universal health care. They're watching Colorado Care to try to figure out how things go here. And they're working in a region with New Hampshire and Massachusetts to see if they can create a big enough pool with the tertiary hospitals that they need so they can have a successful universal health care proposal to their citizens by next year. So Colorado can lead the way. I happen to be a Colorado native, probably several of you are also, and we know that we're a pioneer state with plenty of pioneers. We are often the ones who lead the country in making sure that important policies change that need to be changed. And I'm not talking just about marijuana. I'm talking about women's right to vote. Colorado was the first state to pass a constitutional amendment to give women the right to vote. We can be pioneers on this particular issue because that's often how this is done, is that you initiate a new idea in one state and then it spreads to the rest of the country. So in summary, what I want to particularly highlight is that you can be covered by Colorado Care if you are a Colorado resident and you will own your own financing system, meaning this will be a cooperative that is nonprofit that the people of Colorado own, not a for-profit health insurance coverage plan that is really designed primarily to make a profit for stockholders. And it will be comprehensive lifetime coverage. We'll collect premiums from people based on their ability to pay, and it will cost significantly less than what we are paying now for that good coverage. And finally, I would say, Colorado Care Amendment 69 is not only compassionate, it's also very practical. And I hope that you will support this with your vote in November. Thank you.
Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Katherine Mulready. I'm the Chief Strategy Officer for the Colorado Hospital Association. I'm very happy to be with you this evening. And while we work on PowerPoints and fun technology, I just want to thank you all for being here tonight. Whether this is your first... Oh! Sorry, you need me to do this. All right. I'll put on my best showgirl thing. So Katherine is my name. I'm just happy to be here tonight. I want to thank you for showing up this evening. Whether this is your first foray into Amendment 69 or you've been an advocate on one side or another, I think is the elephant and donkey quilt illustrates the important thing is just that you're engaged. So thank you very much. I'd also like to thank Senator Crowder for being here. I have the fortune of being down at the Capitol with him during the legislative session an awful lot, and he is one of the best rural advocates Colorado has. So thank you for being here and thank you for everything that you do. And I lost track of Senator Nicholson. I'm still used to calling her Senator Nicholson, but thank her for being here wherever she is. Oh, there you are. So thank you very much. In her time in the legislature, Senator Nicholson was a phenomenal advocate for health care, worked a lot with the Hospital Association and in my prior role with the governor's office to advance health care for Coloradans. So she's another wonderful advocate, and I'm happy to be up here with her today. You know, I think the reality with both senators actually is that we probably have a lot more in common and agree on a lot more than we disagree on. Unfortunately, Amendment 69 is one of the things that we do disagree on, and I was asked to come here tonight and present the opposing view. I'm going to skip through a couple slides because sometimes I don't get to present with someone from the proponent side, so we'll skip. You know, I think the important thing as far as Colorado hospitals are concerned, and I should mention that the Hospital Association represents virtually every hospital in Colorado, over 100 hospitals, corner to corner, including San Luis Valley Health and Conejos County Hospital. What we are opposed to is Amendment 69. What we're not opposed to necessarily is single payer. We support universal coverage. We have done a lot of work with Senator Nicholson and others to help expand Medicaid coverage in Colorado. Senator Crowder's been an advocate for that as well. And to find a healthcare system that is sustainable for Coloradans. The reason that we're fundamentally opposed to Amendment 69 is because we're worried that it will threaten the sustainability of Colorado hospitals. That could be San Luis Valley Health. That could be some of those tertiary care, those specialty hospitals that Senator Nicholson mentioned towards the end of her presentation that do deliver that high quality, world-class care that frankly people from all around the Western United States come to Colorado for right now. So I'm going to focus my limited time because I like doing questions and these kinds of things. I think it's a better way to figure out what you're really interested in. But I do have kind of 10 thoughts or facts or takeaways as we go through. So the first thing is that Colorado Care will control $38 billion in spending, including the $25 billion in new taxes that Senator Nicholson mentioned. The rest of that money, that what's on top of the tax, comes from money that we already spend in healthcare. And we do spend about $36, $37 billion in healthcare in Colorado currently. Colorado Care, though, would consolidate that into this one government-run healthcare program. For a little bit of perspective, that would put it on par with large multinational firms that have spent literally hundreds of years building up those reserves and that capital and that infrastructure to operate a business. So if you can't see the slide, Colorado Care would sit kind of right between American Express and United Airlines in terms of its scale and size. The Colorado Care Board that would fundamentally make a lot of decisions about how Colorado Care is implemented and governed over a period of time had some shortcomings. Although they're elected, their accountability really is limited. They don't require any experience to operate a $38 billion entity. They aren't subject to citizen-initiated recall, so you can't actually get rid of someone until their term's up. And they're not subject to state campaign finance limits, which means we could see a lot more money in politics, especially when it comes to governing the healthcare industry. And for us, that's concerning. Senator Nicholson talked about this a little bit, but we'll still have to deal with multiple payers of healthcare. And I would say that the forecasters would put this on one of two tracks. So either Colorado Care can fulfill the many promises it makes, but we'll still have some other payers out there. Medicare, TRICARE, Veterans Administration, none of those federal insurance programs will go away, so we'll still have to deal with those. But most people, and these numbers come from the nonpartisan, nonprofit Colorado Health Institute, they're like a think tank for healthcare in Colorado, 80% would have Colorado Care. What we see in a lot of other countries that have single payer, though, including actually in the United States when it comes to Medicare, is that often the benefits in the public program aren't quite good enough to cover everyone's needs. And so there's private insurance that sits on top of that. So if you have Medicare, for example, you've probably heard of Medicare Advantage or Medicare Supplement plans that kind of enhance the Medicare benefits that are available. We think it's likely that those types of plans will continue to operate in Colorado. And so that limits the administrative savings that the proponents claim will have, because we'll still have to have payment systems that can adapt to all of those various payer types. And you might have multiple types of insurance, and maybe some of you do now. You know, there are a lot of kind of presumed apples to apples comparisons. What you pay in Colorado Care will be less than what you're paying today. I think the question to ask, though, is what are you buying? So if you assume that the healthcare you buy today is an apple, is it really an apples to apples comparison for Colorado Care? And I think the reality is that we just don't know yet. Although there are some boundaries as to what Colorado Care will have to cover, there are a lot of things that are unknown about what Colorado Care will cover. And so even though you might get some health insurance, it might not be an apple. It might be a banana or a pineapple or a watermelon. And so it's hard to know, or something smaller like a grape. You know, it may not be the same kind of coverage that you have today. The actual language of the amendment covers 11 categories of benefits. I think in all total, those 11 categories of benefits are about 60 or fewer words about what your health coverage has to be. But there's a lot that's not in there. And I think it's aspirational that the proponents of Colorado Care want to cover more. But as I'll show you in a second, the economics might just not work. I'm going to pivot away from economics for a minute and talk a little bit about kind of what it means to have a single-payer healthcare system, because the benefits that are within Colorado Care will be governed by this elected board, and the benefits that aren't in Colorado Care won't be covered, and so you might need to pay more for out of pocket for those services if they're not covered. There's also some chance that Colorado Care will get in the way of decisions that you should be making with your doctor. And hopefully under today's system, although it is far from perfect, hopefully you can make those decisions with your doctors and other healthcare providers today. You know, I use this as an opportunity to talk about some of the organizations that aren't supporting Colorado Care, that aren't just healthcare industry people. I think probably three of the largest and most influential left-leaning organizations that are opposed to Colorado Care would be Progress Now, which is a pretty socially liberal group of Democrats, largely based in Denver, but Progress Now Colorado does not support Colorado Care and came out very actively against it with some of the elected legislators that participate in their circle. NARAL Pro-Choice Colorado, which is an organization that is focused on pro-choice initiatives, and Planned Parenthood are also opposed to Amendment 69, as is Governor Hickenlooper, former Governor Bill Ritter. One of the things that I touched on a little bit briefly is how much we try to work together to make healthcare better in Colorado. Again, it's not perfect. I am not a defender of the current system. I like to blow things up and start over. we just don't think that Colorado Care is the right solution for the problems that we have. We have been able, using kind of that pioneering spirit that Senator Nicholson talked about, to do a lot of things on our own as Colorado, irrespective of the Affordable Care Act, although the Affordable Care Act was kind of a big step up that allowed us to move forward. But we've created things like the hospital provider fee, which I know Senator Crowder is a supporter of, as we debate some issues around that now. It's a huge support to San Luis Valley Health. It's a program that allows us to draw down federal dollars to help support hospitals that serve more Medicaid patients. And that particularly helps rural hospitals. Unfortunately, under Colorado Care, we see one of two things happening to that $2 billion pot of money. One, it's incompatible with Colorado Care, and the feds don't let us do it anymore. In which case, that money goes away. And we don't have $38 billion, we have $36 billion. Second, it is somehow compatible with Colorado Care, but the protections that we have for the hospital provider fee might go away because the provider fee is part of the pot of money that's transferred over to Colorado Care, and we don't know what an elected board will do with it. And so that becomes a huge risk area for our hospitals, and particularly for our rural hospitals, and I'll speak for Connie a little bit here and say, and particularly for the Valley. Senator Nicholson talked a bit about workforce. I think whether you look at workforce as healthcare workforce or kind of our economic engine in Colorado generally, we're worried that Colorado Care is a disincentive for people to come to Colorado or stay here. For those of you who don't know, Connie Martin, she's the CEO of San Luis Valley Health. She's sitting in the second row, so I keep referencing her. We were talking before this, and the hospital is trying to recruit two physicians right now. And both of those physicians have asked to put their recruiting on hold until we figure this out on election day, because they're not comfortable committing to come to Alamosa because we don't know what we're doing with our healthcare system yet. And they see this as a huge risk for their careers, and they're both out of state right now. We've certainly heard from other communities, and I think it would probably apply to Alamosa and other border communities, that folks are already talking about moving out of state, and they'll drive back in to work or whatever, but they may not live here anymore, and that hurts our economy generally, whether they're doctors and nurses and med techs and other things, or whether they're businesses, because frankly, our business taxes would be among the highest in the country. This is a slide that is probably the most important slide, and what I'd really like you to take away are the numbers I'm going to walk through in a second. $38 billion, or 36 if we don't get the provider fee, won't be enough money. And the question is just how soon won't it be enough money? In healthcare economics, we know healthcare is expensive. I'm not a defender of the current system. But when there's not enough money, systems can only do one of three things. First, they can cut benefits. There's only so much benefit that you can cut in Colorado Care, so that's kind of a limited option. Second, you can cut how much you pay healthcare providers. And that's probably your most flexible option. But it's not very good if you want to ensure that your providers stay in your community. And third, you can raise taxes. And Senator Nicholson mentioned the value, and I think it is a value, of being able to vote on your tax increases. But what if you say no? And you want them to figure it out on $38 billion in perpetuity. What will that mean for you, and what will that look like? So the numbers that are on the left side of this slide here are really important. And again, these are not opposition campaign numbers or the hospital association's numbers. These numbers are from the nonpartisan, nonprofit Colorado Health Institute. I respect their work greatly. I use it every day. ColoradoHealthInstitute.org. You can read the report for yourself, and I encourage you to do so. What they did is take a kind of a 10-year projection on what Colorado Care is going to cost and looked at factors. And they did a best-case scenario and a worst-case scenario. And they did a middle-of-the-road, like all else equal, here's the middle-of-the-road scenario. Under their worst-case scenario, by 2027, Colorado Care will be operating at a $14 billion annual deficit. In the best-case scenario, right, everything goes the right way. They will be operating a $2 billion annual deficit. The middle of the road version was $7.8 billion annual, every year, deficit. The factors are listed up there and they go into a lot of detail. It's like a 14-page report. But the last one there is the most important, which is just that future tax revenue question. I teach at the University of Denver sometimes, and so I apologize if I'm getting a little too professorial, but you're a college town, you can handle it. So the reason that future tax revenue is the most important thing to consider with Colorado Care is because tax revenue grows at a fairly low rate. Tax revenue grows at roughly 1 to 3% a year. 3% is if like your economy's booming and it's awesome. Healthcare costs in the United States grow at 6.5% a year. And so fundamentally you have this structural problem where the money you're bringing in just can't come in as fast as the money you have to spend going out. And it's probably the number one reason why we don't support Colorado Care is because we're just building a structural problem for healthcare into our constitution. Not saying we don't have problems and that we shouldn't come together as communities and as Colorado to work on those problems and solve them. And CHA is actively engaged in this work. But Colorado Care just isn't that solution. Kind of getting to that, it's really only a refinancing mechanism. There's nothing actually in it to control healthcare costs, which is what we need in Colorado and across the US. Let's see, that's right. And finally, oh, that's so hard to see. So this is, if you can't see it, it's an actual Humpty Dumpty that fell off the wall. It's an actual brown egg that is no longer in its shell. It's a cute picture. But the question here of what if it doesn't work? The board does have the ability to shut Colorado Care down if they can't get the right waivers and approvals from the federal government to make it work. But what will we have lost in the meantime? And will we be able to put our system that works today, through which you can get healthcare, back together again? So happy to open for questions.
What would be the transition? What would the transition period be? When would it be active? Would there be any lapses in coverage during the transition? Katherine? Transition period.
We estimate that the transition period will be 2 years. When this passes this fall, we would initiate the process for developing the infrastructure in January of 2017 with appointments by the leadership in the legislature and appointments by the governor of a 15-member board of trustees who will then do the hard work of creating the infrastructure for this new payment system. And if all goes well, we would be done with the transition period by January of 2019 and ready to actually pay for healthcare that people need. Now, one of the points that I want to bring out is that the Colorado Health Institute report that the opposition likes to talk about suggested that we can't get that money from the federal government to make this work financially. That is, in my opinion, not true. I disagree with Colorado Health Institute's report because when I read the hospital provider fee regulations at the federal level, there was nothing in it that suggested that the money cannot be used for this new way of paying for health care. And there are several examples of state innovations by the Center for Medicare and Medicaid that suggest that they want at the national level through the Medicaid division to encourage state innovation, and indeed Colorado Care is a perfect example of state innovation.
Okay. Try to stick to the answer of the question. But thank you, Jeanne.
You're welcome.
And I'll just add one thing. So, Jeanne very astutely noted that there's a lot of stuff that doesn't belong in our Constitution, right? Like the details that we might want to change over time. I totally agree. So how Colorado Care works is it kind of sets up the framework and then it defers to the legislature and says the legislature needs to pass a bunch of laws. Having worked with the legislature for a long time, sometimes they don't like to play along with that plan, and they don't always agree on how to do all those details that are really important, and find that the devil is quite often in all those details. And so even though the plan is to be up and running by 2019, if our legislators can't work out a deal to implement some of those details, or they go vastly awry, that could be problematic.
Okay, thank you. People move to Colorado, how long will it take them to get Colorado resident status, and what is the financial implication?
One of the big concerns is that very sick people will come to Colorado and undermine the financial stability of Colorado Care. There is no evidence to suggest that will be the case. In fact, that is indeed speculation. What evidence we do have is that we expanded Medicaid in Colorado. Other states did not. And we have no evidence that people who were very sick came to Colorado to get care because we expanded Medicaid and they couldn't get that care paid for in their own state. Another example is that in Saskatchewan, a province in Canada where they first started universal health care for that country in the 1940s, they did not have any evidence that people came from other provinces to Saskatchewan to get health care because the coverage was better. What happened in Saskatchewan is that the neighboring provinces said, well, we want what those guys have. And so they put pressure on their governments to make sure that they got the same kind of coverage that their neighbors had. Finally, the residency definition is one that the Board of Trustees will have to create once the Board of Trustees is serving in their first meeting. That will probably be one of the first things on their agenda, is to define who is a resident of Colorado and therefore eligible for Colorado Care Amendment 69 coverage. And we don't know exactly how they'll define it, but we do know that their interest will be in making sure that Colorado residents have good coverage and that it doesn't undermine the financial system to do so. And we know, and you and I know, that we have that authority as a state to define residency requirements because, for example, you have to live in the state for so many days before you can vote in an election. It will be a decision that will be a similar policy by the Board of Trustees.
Thank you.
Keep it quick. So on the residency definition, yeah, the board will figure it out. I think that the catch-22 choice they have there, though, is either they make it hard to get Colorado care, in which case it inhibits people from moving here, right? And they still have to pay the taxes for a year. Or they make it easy, in which case people may move here. And I would probably point to marijuana and what that has done for our border communities in particular, as yeah, maybe people aren't moving, and not necessarily in a good way. What people are willing to do in terms of crossing borders as a recent example for Colorado.
Okay, thanks. Of the 5.3 million people living in Colorado today, how many will not pay into the system based on their income? I don't know if you, either one of you really have that number, do you, really? We can make one up. If you don't have the number, let's go on to another question.
Well, let me say, the people who are enrolled in Medicaid for the entire year will not pay for Colorado Care coverage because they are enrolled in and indeed eligible for Medicaid. So our very limited income members of Colorado will not pay into Colorado Care, but the rest of us will.
But they'll continue to be covered by—
Yes.
Yeah. Is low income exempt in a similar manner to Social Security? It's the same thing. I'll add to it quick. And the other ones here are the same questions we've kind of covered before. Okay, what is the single person income exemption at age 65?
Oh, 30.
Or?
It's 33,000 is the exemption for Social Security, certain kinds of retirement program income, if you are filing as an individual. But I would caution you not to rely on these numbers without looking at exactly what your personal circumstances are, because there are some people that have that are eligible for an even higher exemption, and for that reason you really need to either go to the website and calculate it or ask an accountant to help you with that.
You like to add to that?
Yeah, just
Catherine.
Thanks. I would really echo Senator Nicholson's comments on checking your own personal situation, particularly if you're a Medicare recipient right now, because this is designed to be secondary to Medicare, so your Medicare will stay in place, and that's really important. What this will also be secondary to is if you have any Medicare Parts B or D supplemental coverage and you pay for that, this will be secondary to that. And there may be Medicare, kind of Medicare Advantage-like benefits provided by Colorado Care, but we don't know that for sure yet. The language allows the board to do that, but we don't know if we'll have enough money to do that. So again, it's complicated, and it should be complicated, but I would caution you to definitely check with an accountant or somebody like that.
We have a lot of questions as I read them through here about pay and what it is. You know, if you're both employed and self-employed, I think the bottom line can be said, what it would be is your taxable income, right? And if it's income from the employer, it's 3%, and your own, it would be 10% on or less on your taxable income. But is that right?
Yeah, let me add that right now, the way the insurance companies cover you is, well, if you're paying for yourself, you pay this X premium, and if you add your spouse, then it's a higher premium, and then if you have a family, children that you're covering, then it's the family plan, and that's a higher premium. But with Colorado Care, if you are the individual income earner in your home, whatever is deducted through the payroll, the 3 1/3% of your income as the employee covers not only you, but your spouse and your children. So it's different in that sense.
So if a married couple has two incomes, are you paying twice?
We would not consider it paying twice. We would say you are paying based on your ability to pay.
On your total income, there would be the total if you're filing separately, it'd be separate. If you're filing joint, it'd be your joint taxable income, right?
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah, and I'm fearful of proxies like it's a 10% tax, because I agree it's complicated. I think so everyone is like, self-care is a good place to start, right? And then we think about our communities. So for everyone who gets really excited about paying less, if that's your situation, just remember that that's less money in the system to help pay for the care that everybody else gets, right? So it's a little bit of it's a huge challenge, right? Because frankly, we want healthcare to cost less, but what we pay in doesn't make healthcare cost less.
Here's a different one. How will hospitals be compensated? Jeanne?
They will be compensated based on the negotiations between Colorado Care staff and that particular hospital. But to be perfectly clear, many of the procedures that we need as citizens are reimbursed to the hospitals at varying rates across the state, and we don't think that that is necessary. We think that those rates should be the same, and we also think that you should, as a hospital or as a provider, should be paid the same for a Medicaid enrollee as you are any other patient that comes to your hospital for care. And so they will all be compensated the same amount regardless of whether these people are on Medicaid or not, and it will be a flat amount. Now, there is language in the initiative that says over time, the Board of Trustees can assess what we call value-based payment for services, because what we think is important is that people get the best health outcomes. And so if there is a way for us to reward hospitals for providing better health outcomes, lower infection rates, less people who have to be readmitted to the hospital, then we will want to look at systems that reward that kind of outcome, because Colorado Care isn't interested in making a profit. They're interested in all of us being healthy.
Would you like to respond to
that? Yeah. I'm the hospital person. I get to respond. So I think the first thing is negotiation is a really kind word when you have 80% market share. So the hospitals don't get to negotiate with Colorado Care very much. They'll be kind of the only game in town, or at least a really big game. They won't have any negotiating power. We'd love that having everyone pay the same. That would make our lives really simple, except that we might still have private payers that might not pay the same. If you don't want Colorado Care coverage and you want something else, or if you have a supplemental plan, or et cetera, et cetera. There are lots of exceptions to that rule. I think the other piece, and what Senator Nicholson called value-based payments, we're doing today in Medicaid. We're doing this in Medicare. In fact, nationally, Medicare, I think, has a goal to have 60% of its participants in some type of value-based alternative payment model, is what they call them, by 2019. To be perfectly honest, Colorado Care will hold us back from doing that because it'll take them so long to get on that path. But I don't think we'll be there by 2019 or by 2029.
All right. Thank you. Here's two that are probably about the same category, some loaded questions. Okay, your CHA associate members include Cigna and United Healthcare. How can we be sure your claims against 69 are in the interest of Coloradans and not your insurance supporters? Loaded question. And is there a neutral party that can fact check the opposing positions or pros and cons?
Associate members for Colorado Hospital Associations are sponsors of our conferences, so they pay for booths at our conference. They're not actual members. Our members are hospitals, and they're hospitals that have two beds in the middle of nowhere, Colorado. Kremling is our smallest hospital. As I mentioned, Families Valley Health, Mahos County, and the Regional Medical Center, and 98 other hospitals, including big systems in Denver that you might go to if you have a really severe need or a specialty that's not offered in your community. Those are our members, and those are the organizations that we speak for. We take that really seriously. I don't know if you could tell tonight, I'm a pretty progressive advocate. I am not anti-single payer. I think it's probably where we need to head in the long run. I don't think it's possible to do at the state level. Just don't think it's possible, because you can't change national cost trends, and that's really what we're fundamentally trying to do in healthcare. But we do agree that you shouldn't be asked about your copay when you're going into anaphylactic shock. That stuff shouldn't happen. We should be focused on care. I think administrators got kind of a bad rap, and so I would just like to recognize our SLVRMC administrators who are here tonight, because I work for them and they do a really great job. So Connie, Greg, everyone else, thank you very much.
Would you like to respond to me? Okay. Let's see. How will the unemployed be covered? I think same as anybody else, they're resident. How will people applying for disability be covered? They're resident, they're covered. might not be able to pay premiums, but the idea is everybody's covered. So I think, how long will we be covered if we move out of state? In other words, this is a question I kind of had too, of moving out of state, or companies that move you out of state and into another state, there probably are some problems there. Would you like to respond?
It will be the same as it is now when you move out of state and need coverage in another state. You might choose to have a COBRA plan as an interim through Colorado Care just to get you through that transition period to pick up the policy that you'll have in the other state. It's actually not any different than our circumstances right now. So you would be losing coverage here and hopefully gaining as good a coverage as possible wherever you move to.
Okay, would you like to respond to no? Okay. This says for Jeanne. What do unemployed residents pay? We've already covered that. Do employees have to pay? Do all employers have to pay? Right now, some managers to escape by part-time. And how much do college students have to pay? It's 3% based on taxable income. That would be an employer. If you're
yes, all employers will pay, and they will pay 6 2/3% of the payroll, unless they choose to pay the full amount, the 10%, and in that case, they are saying to their employees, we'll pick up the full tab for the cost of your coverage. You don't need to pay even a small portion of it. Next question was college students, if they are working part-time while they're going to college, 3 1/3% of whatever they're being paid by their employer would be paid into the system to get their coverage. If they're not working while they're going to college, then they would be covered by their parents' plan. And right now, you know that there's a certain age limit on the coverage through the Affordable Care Act. That would go away. It would be, you know, you might have a kid in medical school and they are almost 30, and they would still be covered under their parents' plan if they were not working and contributing through their employer.
Would you like to respond, Katherine? No. Okay. How will Colorado Health Act affect those with PERA?
Well, I happen to be on PERA myself, and it will be the first amount of money that is exempt, will not be taxed from PERA. So, for example, if you're filing as an individual and you're in fairly average circumstances financially, the first $33,000 of your PERA income would be exempt. So, you know, let's say you made $43,000 through PERA, you would pay the tax on the $10,000 difference. And so that would be $1,000 a year for your supplemental coverage that could replace any supplemental coverage that you might have now that's on top of your on top of your Medicare coverage.
Is that only if you're 65 or over?
Yes, if you're 65, yes.
Then
it's graduated exemption, and that's why I want to reinforce, both of us do, that we can't really tell you your individual circumstance. You really need to calculate that on your own or get an accountant to help you with that to make sure that you know exactly what you'll expect to pay.
Right, I do have one.
Would you like to respond?
Yeah. Okay. This is again, like, talk to an accountant. However, to the extent that your decision on whether to vote on Amendment 69 hinges on whether it will cost you more or less, just remember that all of these projections are totally preliminary, right? We are guessing in 2014, 2015, and 2016 what healthcare is going to cost and how we're going to finance this whole thing starting in 2019 and forever into the future. I have total faith in the intentions of the proponents of the amendment, right? I have faith in their economists. However, we're all guessing, and economists guess a lot, right? So do the opponents' economists. We don't know what it'll actually look like, and so while we can kind of forecast what it might cost you, we don't know if we'll need to ask for an additional tax increase before we ever get benefits. So again, certainly to the extent you feel like you need those projections for yourself to make a good informed decision, talk to a financial professional, but don't put all of your eggs in that basket.
Okie dokie. You have a quick directed to that? Yes.
I didn't hear an answer to the third party neutral entity that might be able to weigh. We're hearing stories continually. And I'd like to use a mechanism that we, I trust both these women. I'm sure they're both very sincere, but I'm hearing two different things.
Right.
So how do I decide?
That was one question you asked that didn't quite get answered. I don't know if there is an
let me answer that.
I don't know.
The Colorado Health Institute would be, by many people, considered an independent, objective third party that is highly respected for the kind of research they do about healthcare costs in Colorado. However, as I mentioned before, I think that when you look on their website, chi.org, you'll see a really comprehensive, very well done, thorough report, but I think they jumped to the wrong conclusion about whether it would be financially sustainable because they assumed that we wouldn't be able to get the federal funds for Medicaid that we would need to make sure that it is financially strong enough. So that's the answer to the question that I know is that that's the one third party. But even that one, you need to take with a grain of salt because if you don't read the hospital provider fee regulations yourself, you won't know whether you can agree with them or not agree with them about their conclusion.
I think we need a good cheat sheet.
I was just going to ask you a question. Has CMS weighed in on that so that the difference between making it financially viable and not viable is the Medicaid funding? Do we have any federal assurance that the Medicaid funding will come through for the program? Has CMS said they would do that?
No, and they can't until 2017 because the Affordable Care Act said we will consider waivers in 2017 but not before. And so we won't know for sure what they say, but what we do know is that there's a significant long track record of them supporting state innovation in the last several years. So that's very encouraging, even though it's not a guarantee. And as we've both mentioned, if we don't get that money, we have an escape clause in this initiative. And the escape clause says, if there's not sufficient money to make this financially sustainable, we won't start the program. And any money that we've collected to be ready for the infrastructure that we will need that is not already spent just in the initial administrative costs, which will be significant, will go back to the people to make sure that we go back to square one and we're back to where we are right now.
So the only thing I'll add to that is, and this is where I get into policy wonkery that no one wants to deal with, but it's important. So the Affordable Care Act created this option for states to create their own program starting in 2017. They're called Section 1332 waivers. There's five states that are already working on them. They are really exciting, but there are rules to them. The biggest rule is that it has to be cost neutral to the federal government. So the federal government will not give you more money than they are giving you now to do your program. That said, the federal government gives Colorado a significant amount of money for Medicaid recipients. I think that ColoradoCare will be able to retain those funds, right? And I'm hopeful that ColoradoCare would be able to retain those funds. Even then, you still have that structural problem of healthcare costs grow faster than your revenue as paid through tax. So I don't read the Colorado Health Institute's report as being entirely dependent on the hospital provider fee or federal funding. It is entirely dependent on your tax base and how much healthcare costs. But to your question, sir, about the neutral forum, best resource ever is the very exciting blue book that should arrive in your mailboxes in a couple of weeks. It is actually intended to be a nonpartisan, demonstrate both sides review of all of the stuff on the ballot, not just this one. And I would encourage you to read that for any initiatives you're interested in. It's written by the nonpartisan legislative staff. They seek input from both sides of all issues, and then it's vetted again through a legislative committee of elected officials like Senator Crowder. And so it is actually the official nonpartisan guide, and in addition to the Colorado Health Institute, it would be a really good resource.
I'm going to try. Go on. We like there's some other big things. A couple more. How does a resident that has prepaid lifetime policy, i.e. TRICARE or VA, will they have to then pay again into the Colorado system?
Yep.
The answer is yes. Everyone pays into this system, even someone who has TRICARE. What this would mean for people on TRICARE is that ColoradoCare would be their supplemental should there be something that TRICARE didn't cover that they needed.
And is there a set amount each person will receive? I don't think so. Where do cancer, terminally ill, and chronically ill patients fall into this amendment? I don't know if they're any different than anybody else. Okay. Do you think there will be a large influx of Colorado residents? I think you talked about that already. Kind of don't expect it. And there's another one here, the same thing. What would prevent it from a whole bunch of people moving in? They probably wouldn't. That's not the case for most of these things. A few might, but it wouldn't really impact as much. And, okay, what about cost increases to small businesses with less than 50 employees? Well, it would probably someone would have to start paying because we've already kind of addressed that. Every employee would have to pay their 6 points, their two-thirds.
Six and two-thirds.
This should not be in the Constitution. I think that's a comment because of Tabor. It is a... Okay, so that's more of a comment than a question. Has healthcare provider concerns incorporate VA, especially for rural vets who have much trouble traveling? Universal codes and computer programs? Not sure. Is that all yours?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Can you boil it down to one question?
No way.
Yeah.
But I can kind of hurry through it. Upwork email these to you. As a former healthcare provider, and I still do home care and have lots of veterans on my radar, one of my frustrations has been that the VA benefits are all mostly on the front range. And they even dump some of these little people that are from still World War II on the sidewalk in Denver, back to busing them up there to deal with all that stuff by themselves. I long hope that the VA would be a insurance that is just like any other insurance, and they can walk into any facility in their region. So I would like that addressed in a universal healthcare system. Universal codes computer programs. It's very frustrating as a provider to have to sit there and spend hours trying to figure out what to do with what code. How do we tackle issues They come up with the present satisfaction-driven pay. I don't know if any of you understand that or how many of you do, but my daughter works as a nurse in a hospital in Denver. And if her patients are not satisfied with their care, Medicaid no longer pays the hospital the full amount of the cost of their care. You know how some patients are. So that's not necessarily a fair way to get paid or not paid. Color coding of bill versus lab versus history. Lawsuit limitations. I would love to see that in something like this. We've talked about that a lot. If you do have actual poor care or care that leads to debilitation or whatever, that should be paid for, but not the zillions of dollars and everything you're going to earn for the rest of your life. And I think that it's crippling doctors to pay some of the overhead of that. Cultural medical issues with end of life. Terminal care, which is often wasteful and expensive at the last minute because as a culture, we don't deal with this before it comes up.
I agree with everything you said. And some of these issues that you're pointing out will be addressed. I think this is probably, from my perspective, the kinds of issues that I would hope you would bring to the Board of Trustees and say, here are some problems that in the system that we've had in the past, how can we make this better with this new system? But I don't think we can address this specifically in the constitutional language because you don't want those kind of specifics in the Constitution. You want general concepts in the state Constitution, and then you want to work out those kind of important details through the Board of Trustees.
I think there's going to be challenges in all of those issues with Colorado Care without it. You don't have to wait for Colorado Care, right? I mean, VA stuff, a little challenging, right? But the rest of all of those issues are well within the state legislature's purview today, right? And Senator Crowder's still here, so I'm sure he'd be happy to listen. and I'd be happy to stay after and talk. I do think on the hope and aspiration that Colorado Care can address some of those and a thousand other tricky, thorny issues. If they can afford it, I trust that they'll get there. If they can't afford it, what will happen?
I think what we'll, given the time, there's a few cards I'm sorry to get to, but I think they'll be around and answer your individual questions. Let's thank both our presenters.